atheist Richard Dawkins was professor of public understanding of science at the University of Oxford from 1995 to 2008. Dawkins' 2006 book, The God Delusion, has sold over 3 million copies and has been translated into over 30 languages. The book has been and remains influential. This past July on Steinbach's Main Street, during Steinbach's outdoor festival, Summer in the City, I saw the God Delusion displayed at a kiosk sponsored by a group called Humanists, Atheists, and Agnostics of Manitoba. The book was sitting there as if it were kind of a holy book. In the book's crucial fourth chapter, Dawkins argues that the objection or question, who designs the designer, or who designed the designer, blocks any reasonable inference to a designer. In today's Prov talk, I will argue that this important objection, a popular objection, is a philosophical failure, a philosophical blunder. First, I will clarify the objection, and I will set up my critique, and then I will consider a couple of objections to my critique. It's important to begin by noting that Dawkins acknowledges that there is a complexity to nature which looks designed. Dawkins has famously stated this: biology is the study of complex things that appear to have been designed for a purpose. But, Dawkins emphasizes, the design is merely apparent. According to Dawkins, who designed the designer objection? Appealing to an intelligent designer to explain nature's complexity, that is, its apparent design, is an explanatory failure. Why? Because it merely passes the explanatory buck. The intelligent designer hypothesis transfers the mystery of nature's complexity, which is the puzzle to be explained, to the mystery of the designer's complexity, which is a new puzzle to be explained. But this in turn generates another puzzle, i.e. the mystery of the complexity of the designer's designer. And this generates another puzzle, the mystery of the complexity of the designer's designer, and so on. More specifically, Dawkins argues that because the complexity of the natural world, i.e. that's its apparent design, is highly improbable, and because the intelligent designer must be at least as complex as the complexity of the natural world, it follows that the intelligent designer must be at least as improbable as the natural world. But, Dawkins continues, this is to explain one improbability by another improbability at least as great as or greater than the first improbability. What is worse for the intelligent design proponent, the question of the origin of the designer adds yet another layer of improbability to explain the additional complexity of the designer's designer. Then the question of the complexity of the designer's designer adds yet another layer of improbability, and so on ad infinitum. Because of this unending regress of additional improbabilities, Dawkins thinks that the God hypothesis, the God explanation, is not a reasonable explanation for the apparent design found in nature. In fact, Dawkins thinks that his argument renders God extremely improbable. Dawkins concludes, God almost certainly doesn't exist. Thus, God is illusory. Of course, the question arises, is Dawkins' who designed the designer argument logically sound? I think Dawkins' who designed the designer argument is not sound for at least two reasons. First, it relies on a false premise. It's false that the complexity of a designer makes a design hypothesis improbable. Intelligent designer explanations are accepted in science and in everyday reasoning, even if the designer is complex. For example, in archaeology, to explain cave paintings and arrowheads. In cryptography, to explain codes. In forensic science, to explain whodunit. In fact, in these sciences, the designer is even more complex than the objects or phenomena explained, yet the designer hypothesis is legitimate. Notice that if we were to accept Dawkins' who designed the designer objection as a block to inferring a designer, then, to be logically consistent, the aforementioned explanations would not be legitimate. But they are legitimate. In archaeology, the designer is more complex than the cave painting, more complex than the arrowhead. In cryptography, the designer is more complex than the code. In forensic science, the designer is more complex than the murder weapon or the event itself. Thus, it's false that the complexity of a designer makes a designer hypothesis improbable. Second, the issue of the complexity and origin of a designer simply has no bearing on the process of determining whether something is designed. It's not relevant. Consider the science known as SETI, or Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. In SETI, the intelligent design hypothesis is allowed to explain ET's communications, if they were to occur. Moreover, and significantly, whether the alleged message is truly a message from ET depends not at all on our knowledge of ET's complexity or origin, but solely on whether the message displays design. How do we discern design? Think about some strings of letters in a Scrabble game. Let's say I'm playing Scrabble with my family and I leave the room to answer a phone call, and when I return, I see these letters. Dad, it's your turn to buy pizza. Now I just should note that I couldn't find our Scrabble game, so I had to go online and just pick that. It seems sort of appropriate. Beer, cake, wine, meat. To discern design, two conditions should be satisfied. We determine whether, one, the thing is highly improbable via non-intelligent causes, given what we know from empirical experience of the capacities of non-intelligent causes, and two, the thing is strongly analogous to things we know also from empirical experience to be designed by intelligent causes. Surely I discern rightly that my family wants pizza, or beer, cake, meat, wine. The letters organizing themselves on their own into Dad, it's your turn to buy pizza is highly improbable. And the particular string of letters is highly analogous to things done by known intelligent causes. Of course, it's possible that I'm mistaken, but I think it's reasonable to think that I'm not. Now consider the message from outer space in the 1997 movie Contact, starring Jodie Foster and Matthew McConaughey, the movie based on the book by Carl Sagan by the same name. Sagan is an atheist. Again, the way to discern whether something is designed is to determine whether, one, the thing is highly improbable via non-intelligent causes, given what we know from empirical experience of the capacities of non-intelligent causes, and two, the thing is strongly analogous to things we know also from empirical experience to be designed by intelligent causes. So in Contact, the message that tweaks intelligent causation consists of a repeating list of the prime numbers up to and including 101. Recall that a prime number is any positive integer greater than 1 and is exactly divisible only by 1 and itself. So recall that the prime numbers are 2, 3, 5, 11, 13, 17, 19, and so on up to 101. Picking out and listing prime numbers is improbable without intelligence. We know this. Picking out and listing prime numbers is strongly analogous to what intelligent causes do. We know this too. It's what mathematicians and scientists like to do in their spare time. Yes, I'm thinking of Prof's resident mathematician, Inga Bamica. Yes, I'm thinking of Prof's resident biologist, Rebecca Diehl Schneider. Yes, I'm thinking of Prof's resident social scientists, Val Hebert, Dennis Hebert, and Morgan Olenga. I risk going a little bit over time here, but I have to tell you about when I was writing this, I had this vision, perhaps vision isn't the right word, imagination. And I imagined a party happening at Morgan Olenga's house. and at this party were the aforementioned scientists, mathematicians, and Inga Bamica has a black felt marker, and he's writing numbers on one of the living room, on one of the walls of the living room, and it's a couple thousand numbers. It's like a large chart like that. And then then we have Dennis and Val and Rebecca twirling Morgan Malenga around because he's kind of going like this. And Morgan is wearing a blindfold, and he's got a tack with looks like a string or something attached to it. And Jackie, Morgan's wife, comes into the room. She's visibly disturbed. She says, "What the heck is going on here?" And I edited my imagination protecting the innocent. And Morgan smiles and he says, "Nothing, honey. We're just playing pin the tail on the prime number." Sometimes it's not a good idea to prepare talks later than that. Okay, back to ET. So the discernment, or inference of intelligent design from the list of prime numbers up to 101 is due to these two conditions being satisfied. One, the thing or pattern is highly improbable via non-intelligent causes, and two, it is strongly analogous to things we know to be designed by intelligent causes. Now notice this. The complexity or origin of the designer, in this case ET, has no bearing on this inference. It is simply not relevant. It's simply not relevant to satisfying those two conditions for discerning design. Who designed ET? That is, who designed the intelligent cause? That is, who designed the designer? Perhaps the designer just is and always has been, or not. Perhaps the designer is complex, or not. The point here is that we need not understand the nature of the designer, whether it's complex or not, or even the origin of the designer, whether it has a designer or not, to determine that something has been designed and by implication that a designer exists. We need only to discern the satisfaction of two conditions. The thing is highly improbable via non-intelligent causes and strongly analogous to things we know to be designed by intelligent causes. Therefore, as an alleged block to discerning a designer from its designed effects, the who designed the designer objection is beside the point. It's not relevant. At this juncture, two objections might be set out to my critique. First, one might be tempted to argue that God is simple, and so the broad explanation does not fall prey to Dawkins' objection concerning complexity. In reply, I'll only say this. I think the doctrine of God's simplicity is an important and difficult philosophical and theological doctrine and should be studied for the sake of achieving greater knowledge of God. However, I think that such a project would be lost on the likes of Dawkins and so would have little apologetical value. More importantly, I think it would be a rabbit trail. The fact remains, as I've argued, that whether the designer is simple or complex is not relevant to the question of discerning whether something is designed, whether by God or a God-like being. I.e., the issue is merely whether the object or phenomenon or pattern in question displays the marks of intelligent design. The nature of the designer is not part of this inference. It's irrelevant. Okay. Second objections. One might object that in my examples, in which we clearly detect design, archaeology, cryptography, forensic science, Scrabble, we model the detectable design on known intelligent causes, i.e., us. But it's not reasonable to do this sort of modeling with any kind of supernatural intelligent agent such as God. God, or so it might be objected, is too different from us. In reply, in the examples of archaeology, cryptology, forensic science, and Scrabble, yes, we are modeling the design inference on known intelligent causes, which happen to be us. But the fact remains that with SETI, search for extraterrestrial intelligence, things get interesting. In SETI, we don't know whether ET is a natural agent or a godlike being or an angel. yet we permit the discernment of design independent of modeling ET's mind. We use known intelligence, ours. If this is reasonable in SETI, which it is, it's reasonable then elsewhere. To say it isn't reasonable elsewhere is to assume that intelligence other than human intelligence can never be modeled on the known effects of human intelligence. But if the issue is whether such intelligence is in fact limited to solely to us, to forward this as an objection is to assume what's at issue. It commits the fallacy of question begging. It assumes as settled that which is at issue. It assumes as settled that there aren't other intelligences somewhat like ours, when that's what we are wondering about. It puts the cart before the horse. It assumes the outcome of an investigation before the investigation begins. We should look and see and let the evidence lead us. Maybe there is a mind or God who has made us in God's image, and so we are able, using empirical investigation, to discern this mind's empirical effects in the created order. Recall that even Dawkins acknowledges that there is, in fact, apparent design in nature. Significantly, then, because Dawkins' who designed the designer objection fails, it does not preclude our discernment of the effects of such a God. Dawkins' who designed the designer objection has two major flaws. It is based on a false premise, and it is basically irrelevant. In other words, the objection that purports to show us that God is a delusion is, to put it mildly, a philosophical blunder. Significantly, nature's apparent design remains and continues to suggest an intelligent designer, as even Dawkins should admit. Thank you.